for rhinos, but it is the cause. It is done. It's a sport that is you do like a rally on really, really challenging terrain, you know? Out there, you know, in the bushes, and you know, you use those cars that your wheels are as high as, you know, in people, and they do the. It's a fun thing to do. It's an adventurous sport to do, and the cause for this, because a lot of corporates sponsor it. All that money goes into conservation of rhinos.
Is that an event then the public can register to participate?
Kenyans participate. Corporates participate. Okay. So we sponsor a car. And we sponsor a driver. Kenyans come in with their, you know, vintage cars that can, you know, with survive in such terrain. And you're up there, you're enjoying yourself. It's once in a year. Mm-hmm. And it is not just the driving. There's also camping. There's also fun activities in the evening. So it's a fantastic way of telling Kenyans, let's conserve the rhino, but, you know, find an adventure thing that nobody else is doing.
Kenya seems to have a very rich history. Is there a particular historical fact that would surprise most people?
Maybe I can use the archaeological fact, because Kenya is a cradle of humankind. The oldest full human body skeleton was discovered in Kenya in 1984 in a place called Lake Turkana. And this, you know, confirms that sometime man used to roam around, you know, Kenya. So that is the origin. Otherwise, why hasn't this been found in other parts of the world?
So at our core, we're all Kenyans.
We are all Kenyans. We just, you know, migrated to other parts of the world. So you need to come back home to Kenya. Visit Kenya and come back home.
To explore Kenya, its natural beauty and cultural diversity, visit magicalkenya.com. We also have a direct link on this show page on worldfootprints.com.
In this destination spotlight, Verena Da Silva shines a light on Sri Lanka from the New York Times Travel Show.
Sri Lanka was formerly known as Ceylon, Ceylon tea, which most people are familiar with, best tea in the world. But we've come through a dark period. We had some political and ethnic problems for 30 years, and there was peace declared in 2009, so all of the shadow of unease is taken away. So there's been a big focus on tourism. We find that Sri Lanka, although it's a small country, has a lot to offer. It's packed with ancient cities going back to 5 BC. It's amazing. And Arthur C. Clarke, who lived there, said it was one of the smallest countries with the most amount of attractions, like a continent. We have mountains, beaches, wildlife, all of it. So it's well worth a visit. The most important thing is that it's a diverse destination. If you go there, you get the full gamut of what tourism is all about, intermixing with the local people, culture, history, iconic buildings, culture from Portuguese, Dutch, and the British. So there's a flavor of all three countries there. Also, if you like to stay in a boutique type hotel which with mountain views or beachscapes, all kinds of different things. So there's something for everyone. When I say I'm from Sri Lanka, people say, where is that? It's a little island off the coast of South India in the Indian Ocean. So if you're going to travel there, you can go from New York through Europe, or you can go from New York to Tokyo and on. We're like right halfway across the world. But don't be put off by the long flight, because it's really worth it. Sri Lanka is predominantly Buddhist, 80% Buddhist, 10% Hindu, and the rest are Christians and Muslims. So everywhere you go, you see a lot of the Buddhist culture with the pagodas and the temples and the religious ceremonies. We have also the Hindu culture. But with the Portuguese, Dutch, and British colonization, we have Dutch forts. We got a lot of the colonial buildings. We even have their food. So you have a mix of cuisines as well. You know, if you are a foodie, it's a great trip to go on, because you can try these different kinds of foods from three different parts of the world.
Best-selling author James Rollins takes us to mankind's next great leap in his newest thriller, The Bone Labyrinth. Using his training as a veterinarian and personal adventures, James explores the mystery of human development and forces us to ask where we are headed as a species.
I understand that your training as a veterinarian has helped you with the development of your newest book, The Bone Labyrinth. How has it helped you?
Well, I love to fold animals. You know, I still do some volunteer work with my veterinary degree, though I do write full-time. But because I've sort of stepped away from full-time veterinary medicine, animals have crept into my writing. A lot of characters have animal sidekicks. But in this case, I have a sort of a unique animal. He's a 3-year-old mountain gorilla. He speaks with sign language. He's got an unusual genetic history. And he is abducted along with his research associate, and it allows me to delve into the sort of the research that goes on with primates. It allows me to explore our human intelligence, where it came from, where it's maybe headed next.
Mm-hmm.
It also lets me explore the issue of doing research on animals, because basically most countries ban or tightly restrict the use of great apes in research, but sadly the United States is not really up to the full restriction that they probably should have on at this point. And so I'd love to explore both the science behind great apes and also maybe shine a light on what's going on in the current research models with them.
The Bone Labyrinth is the 11th Sigma Force series. Can a first-time reader pick up where, say, the Sixth Extinction or the Midnight Watch left off?
Definitely. I mean, I structured the series so that anybody can hop in at any point. Matter of fact, I think 90% of my readers have not read my books in order. They've just picked up the current book, maybe catches their eye, and if they liked it, they fill in the backstory from there. You know, I think if you read the stories in order, there's a little nuance of character, but definitely each novel is self-contained and can be appreciated all by itself.
Now, your book, as you kind of alluded to a little bit earlier, explores the development of human history and intelligence. And I have to ask, you know, as a resident of the Washington, D.C. area, what exactly is human intelligence? Because I don't see much of it here.
That is a challenge. It's so funny. One of the facts I found out is that you know, for the last 200,000 years, our brains haven't changed much, except for the fact that about the last 15 years ago, our brains have actually been shrinking. So maybe that's a reflection of what's going on.
That would explain it, I think. I understand that we also share a common passion for scuba diving. Do you have a favorite dive spot that you like to frequent?
Probably Belize is one of my favorite places to go to. Whenever I go to a new place, I'm looking for two things. I'm looking for a cave to explore and a place to go diving.
And while you do a lot of spelunking, and that's something I haven't tried, what is that like for you, and has it inspired some of your storylines?
They definitely have. You know, I think writers should be writing from a point of passion. And when I was in college, while everybody else was going to keggers and beer parties, I, for some bizarre reason, joined a caving club and was crawling underground. And I still love the fact that, you know, potentially when I'm exploring a new wild cave, that I could be seeing something nobody's seen before. And likewise, even with scuba diving, most of the oceans have not been fully mapped or explored in great detail, so you could be seeing something no one's seen before. And so I love that thrill. I love the challenge. I love the physicality of it. And so I try to fold that into my novels. My excitement about these sports play a critical role in often in different novels of mine, and I hope I'll take my reader and let them experience a little bit of that from the armchair.
You travel a lot. You recently returned from China and had an interesting experience at one of the zoos in China, and I'd like to ask you a little bit more about that.
You go to the Beijing Zoo, and the main star of the Beijing Zoo is the Panda House, and it's a nice, pristine, modern facility. The animals look well kept. But as soon as you sort of wander away from that main tourist attraction of the zoo, where most of the buses are unloaded and the tourists are sort of shipped to and shipped out of, you'll find out the rest of the zoo is in sort of shabby shape. They're ill-kept. They treat animals very badly, and they're very poorly policed. So it's, again, as I love taking sort of details like this and shining a spotlight on them. Matter of fact, one of the things I learned after the fact from talking to somebody associated with the zoo, that once upon a time, the descriptions on the zoo, the little charts or the signs in front of the zoos, in front of the exhibits, used to list, you know, what parts of the animal were edible and the tastiest, and what part of the animals were best used for medicine. So almost the zoo was being used like a menu board.
Oh.
So it was disturbing. Now, those aren't there anymore, but there's still a restaurant at the Beijing Zoo that does serve things like hippopotamus toes and giraffe meat, so it's a little disturbing.
You're listening to World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick. We are talking to best-selling author James Rollins about his life and latest thriller, The Bone Labyrinth, which explores the evolution of human intelligence and asks if mankind's existence is threatened. Visit this show page on our website at worldfootprints.com to read more about The Bone Labyrinth.
I also understand that there's a lack of resources as well, and so I haven't really been able to rationalize a balance between lack of resources, food sources, and with animal care, humanity. And so that's something I still struggle with.
When I was at the zoo, you know, I did find out that they are planning on moving the zoo to a new facility, a large facility outside of Beijing proper. So hopefully we'll see that improve. But, you know, I was looking at, you know, you go to the Olympic Village and you see the amount of money spent at the Olympic Village.
Right.
And just wonder why they can't do a little bit better at the zoo, which is
right.
A tourist attraction. You'd think they would want that to be a shining beacon of their city when it really is sort of a sad.
Right, there. Right. Do you travel to some of the places, for example, the Bone Labyrinth is set in Croatia. Do you travel to some of the settings in your book?
I've actually been to about 70% of the places I write about, I've been to. I don't always necessarily travel for research per se. Like, I'm going to set a story in France. I'm going to fly to Paris, run around Paris, and come back and write about it. I usually just travel for the fun of it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, I love asking people, you know, walk up to one of the locals and ask them, hey, tell me something that nobody knows about this town, a secret nobody knows. I did that in Beijing, by the way, and I learned this detail by asking that question. And this gentleman told me that what most people aren't aware of is that beneath Beijing, there's an entire underground city that was built during the Soviet era so that the entire Beijing population can recede underground if there's ever a nuclear attack. It's still there. It's crumbled into ruin. It collapsed in a few places, but it's still down there. It has many secret entrances down to it. As a matter of fact, during the Tiananmen Square crackdown, that's the way the Chinese government moved troops into position and even tanks into position, was through this underground city, because some of those tunnels are large enough for tanks to roll down. By traveling, asking questions, taking pictures, journaling, oftentimes I just do that for the fun of it. I put it on a shelf, and then whenever I'm building a novel or maybe my characters are coming close to that area, I've got my research and some mysteries all set to go.
Is there a place that has really just resonated with you, a destination, a particular destination?
One probably area that I'd love to explore in greater detail is the Amazon. You know, I wrote a book called Amazonia, which takes place in the Amazon rainforest, but I still am fascinated by that. Maybe that, again, goes back to my roots as a biologist and a veterinarian, about all the strange animals that are out there. And so I'd like to go ahead and at one point revisit that part of the world again.
Mm-hmm. Now, I understand that the Sigma Force has been optioned. There's a movie in development. Do you have any updates, any breaking news for our World Footprints audience?
Well, the entire series has been picked up. I can't give you much more details than that because I've been asked to keep it somewhat quiet in regards to the significant details. But yes, the first book in the series is currently being converted into a screenplay. So hopefully at some point we will see Sigma Force and my characters on the big screen.
To read more about James Rollins and his Sigma Force series, visit his website, jamesrollins.com, or find a direct link on this show page on worldfootprints.com. Listening to World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick. Coming up, we will explore American history through two different perspectives, along America's whiskey trail and through the homes of America's founding fathers with author Myron Magnett. We will also shine a destination spotlight on the beautiful country of Belize. If you want more travel experiences beyond this radio show, we invite you to visit our website.